love is in the air. At least it is in 2004, when crushes are in full bloom. But they don't call EM crushes for nothing, since some first dates don't go as you wouldn't think, unless, perhaps, you think that they're really embarrassing. But 2018 shows us that no one really forgets their first love, no matter how mature and successful, or sad and lonely, they've become. Episode 4, Abalone Feast. Food company exec's son is too excited to receive a call from Dae Young agreeing to work for him that he doesn't take his house guest, CEO Yun's call seriously as she demands the code to be let into his apartment. But when he finds her collapsed in front of his door, he rushes her to the hospital. The doctors say it's mostly stress and exhaustion, but they'll run more tests. Sun gently makes sure the blanket covers her while he waits, looking genuinely concerned. His cousin calls just then to make sure CEO Yun is still with him, and says that she won't be able to go to Korea as soon as she hoped since she still needs time to recuperate from giving birth. Ha, she even starts breastfeeding while still on FaceTime, much to Sun's horror. He heads back to CEO Yun's room, but on the way he sees CEO Yun's sister Jiwoo in her nursing garb. He recognizes her, and she realizes that he's the middle school student she used to tutor. Jiwoo's surprised to see how well he's grown, and he gives her his phone number so they can get together to for a drink sometime. CEO Yun is released from the hospital, but Sun is still concerned for her. She gripes that she's been strong enough to not collapse when her business partner ran off with all her money, or when Sun caught her, but today she collapsed because Sun wouldn't give her the lock code. When they arrive back at Sun's apartment, he purposefully stands so she can see him enter the code. Aware mood also brightens when Sun tells her that Dae Young's agreed to sign the contract. She asks if she'll have her expenses paid now, and Sun agrees, but only until his cousin returns to Korea. CEO Yun even gets Sun to remove his demarcation line and allow her access to the bathroom. Dae Young signs the contract to work at CQ Foods but adds a clause that he can keep his current job. They join the rest of the team who are in the middle of presenting their research on what restaurant they should try. The research is focused more on marketing and business aspects than the food itself, and Dae Young looks a little uncomfortable trying to follow what everyone is saying. Sun says that Dae Young should suggest something, since he knows what's the most delicious. Dae Young admits he's been to all the restaurants everyone has mentioned, but they're so popular that if they went to lunch at any of them, they'd be waiting in line forever. Instead, he suggests a relatively unknown place. It's a little hole in the wall that focuses primarily on abalone. Sun worries that abalone would be too expensive and tricky to deliver as a solo meal, but Dae Young bursts into one of his informative rants about the health and importance of abalone and how solo people would be thrilled to be able to eat a kind of food that normally needs to be properly prepared by more experienced hands. He shows his new team members the best way to appreciate their abalone feast, and everyone digs in. Sun seems a little disgruntled that his team is suddenly listening to all of Dae Young's suggestions instead of his, and decides to take his leave. Dae Young wonders if they have mandatory work dinners, but Sun says that's old-fashioned and he doesn't feel the need to make his team socialize outside of work hours. Except they all want to go out to dinner with Dae Young as a way to welcome him to the company. Sun declines their invitation, saying they'd be more comfortable without their boss there. But he looks kinda jealous that his team is so happy to follow Dae Young. Jiwoo looks at Dae Young's blog and assumes the empty abalone plates mean his team took him out to lunch. She decides to leave him an encouraging comment but discovers that CEO Yun left one first, telling Dae Young that he owes her lunch for helping him get the job. Jiwoo follows the link on CEO Yun's profile and scrolls through CEO Yun's Instagram. Sun calls her just then, asking if she'd like to meet for drinks. That's definitely more appealing than a bowl of cornflakes. Or, Sun still calls her teacher. Jiwoo says that he doesn't need to speak so formally now that they're both adults, but he says he can't help it because she hasn't changed. She thinks it's because she still looks young, but he says it's actually because she's still as short as ever. Ha. Flashback to 2004, where 20-year-old Jiwoo goes to her tutoring assignment. Or, teenaged Sun is an adorably chubby kid who's more focused on ordering food for delivery than his math homework. He happily rattles off all the phone numbers and menus of the delivery places, and Jiwoo marvels that he's able to memorize all that information yet can't memorize a math formula. Sun says that it's because he orders delivery every day since his parents work all the time. After tutoring, Ji-woo rushes home so she doesn't miss her favorite drama, Phoenix. She flings herself in front of the TV just in time to catch Eric Mun say the immortal line, "Do you smell something burning? It's my heart." Seo Yun scoffs at Ji-woo's love of dramas, saying that she wastes her weekend watching stupid dramas instead of dating. Hey now! Seo Yun can't help watching the romantic kiss scene, either. Next door, Dae-young gripes at how messy his friends are, but they don't care, they're too focused on watching the new porn video they just received. Even Dae-young watches in anticipation as the camera pans up a woman's bare leg, but the film switches to a boring nature documentary instead. The boys are angry that their black market porn seller rips them off. An SEOK is sent on a mission by Seo Yun, who requests him to buy her a new tube of lipstick. He ends up getting the color wrong, and the rest of the boys lean out of the doorway, watching as Seo Yun loudly berates him. Ji-woo steps out to intervene, but Seo Yun just yells at Jin Seok to exchange it and then storms off. Ji-woo reassures Jin Seok that she'll take care of it, but his friends are all amazed at how whipped he is. Their shaman neighbor arrives just then and says that she feels a strong, erotic energy in the air and predicts that someone will be kissed soon. It's not exactly the most earth-shattering prediction, since the shaman's talking to a bunch of horny college students, but it's enough to make Ji-woo wonder who it could be. Ji-woo daydreams a romantic and totally drama-worthy scenario where Dae-young confesses his love to her, haha, of course his cheesy line involves bread, and then kisses her. It's a perfect drama kiss, with twinkling background music in multiple angles. Seo Yun returns home to find her sister lost in her daydream. Seo Yun wonders who Ji-woo is pretending to kiss, and embarrassed at being caught, Ji-woo retorts that it's nothing. Seo Yun says that Ji-woo should just confess to Dae-young how much she likes him, but Ji-woo continues to insist she doesn't like him. If that's the case, then Seo Yun says she'll set up a blind date, and Ji-woo hides her disappointment at the idea of Dae-young going on a blind date with another girl. At soccer practice, Ji-woo is dreamily distracted by Dae-young's lips. She also offers to help him practice by playing the goalie, except when she sees him running down the field towards her, she ends up hugging him instead of the stopping the ball. PFFFD. The other boys arrive and are thrilled to reveal to Dae-young that they've lined up blind dates. Annoyed, Ji-woo kicks the